This episode is sponsored by Wix. Go to wix.com/go/simplehistory to create a website now. Life in Edo, Japan, 1603 to 1868. After having taken power through the epic battle of Sekigahara, the Tokugawa family inaugurated a period characterized by a fast economical and urban growth, ensuring their power for the next 2.5 centuries. Like many other social realities at that time, Japan had a highly rigid social structure, even though the emperor was at the top of the hierarchy. The shogun had the effective power, which made him the actual head of the state. Below him, the daimyo ensured the control of the regions Japan was divided into, collecting taxes and ruling over the local samurai. Until that time, samurai had a prestigious role, for they were the best symbol of value and honor, fearless of the possible death that would have occurred in one of the frequent civil wars Japan was used to. However, the stability launched by the shogunate led to a gradual decline of this role, driving many samurai to give up their code and confound themselves with the habits of commoners. Located at the bottom of the social hierarchy, merchants, peasants, and artisans were free of any moral code and judgment, and could spend their free time in the infamous pleasure districts, indulging in amusements and gambling. Although formerly the capital was Kyoto, the residence of the emperor, the power center of the Bakufu, and the most important city in the country was Edo, today's Tokyo, in the eastern part of the country. Chosen by the Bakufu power base merely for strategic reasons, Edo became the leader of a massive expansion caused by natural economic development. It was 1603 when Tokugawa Ieyasu moved the shogunate powerhouse into what was only a small village, esteemed for its position in the eastern part of the country, where Tokugawa's allies were largely located. Following the custom, all the daimyo in the country were obliged to have a second residence in Edo, and to attend there every other year. Perhaps the harshest stipulation placed upon them was that their wives and children had to remain behind in the city when they returned to their own domains, effectively keeping them hostage, although their conditions would be quite comfortable, as long as they didn't try to leave the city. This was all to prove the daimyo's loyalty to the shogun and assuring there would be no kind of revolutionary act. Daimyo also had to swear an oath of loyalty, as it was forbidden to conclude alliances among themselves. Tokugawa's grandson, Imitsu, would confiscate daimyo lands and give them to other lords if he didn't trust them. Daimyo had an inner hierarchy, depending on the level of trust the shogun had towards them. The ones placed at the bottom of the rank were usually sent to rule the faraway provinces. As daimyo and samurai livened up the former fisherman's village, artisans and merchants congregated to the city, sensing great business opportunities and contributed to the development of a modern metropolis, which was able to pass in only 50 years from a few thousand residents to 400,000. The number of sento, or public baths, rose exponentially, and soon they became an important meeting point for all the population. The great success of the sento is also due to the yuna, masseuses, that mainly had to clean the customer's back, but could occasionally also perform for them, playing music, singing, or dancing. Tokugawa Ieyasu wanted Edo Castle to be a symbol of his supremacy, and he financed its reconstruction, which took more than 4 decades to complete. Edo Castle was sacred and impenetrable, but an exception was made for the Kanda Matsuri. In order to celebrate the Sekigahara victory, Tokugawa Ieyasu launched the Kanda Festival, which took the name from the nerve center of Edo. The event had to be as peculiar and lavish as possible in order to show the greatness of the ruler. Only on that occasion did the floats have permission to cross the castle walls. Only one castle was allowed within the limits of Edo. The other existing fortresses in the rest of the country, at this point useless for their defending functions, were used as luxurious homes by the daimyo. Geographically speaking, Edo was overlooked by an elevated area, Yamanote, that looked at the castle to the north, south, and west where the upper-class residents were. The lower area, Shitamachi, placed at the east of the castle, was surrounded by channels and hosted the lower classes. The urban landscape was adjusted constantly throughout the years. A fast growth urged easy-to-build constructions, and the abundance of wooden houses was the cause of the numerous fires, which periodically burned down the city. One such event was the Mereki Fire, which occurred in 1657. It's estimated that 100,000 people died in this tragedy. the event resulted in new standards for the urban layout, and gradually Edo was thrown into the modern era, growing to host 1 million inhabitants in 1720. The streets of Edo were busy with activity. You'd see merchants selling their wares on the streets, such as books, tea, and rare textiles coming from the overseas territories. Street food was extremely popular. Vendors of all kinds shouted out, seeking the attention of potential customers walking by, trying to attract them to their stand selling dried eels, soba noodles, boiled beans, rice, fried tofu, and sushi, vitalizing the streets of the city. People loved to gather for outdoor activities such as cherry blossom viewing and full moon viewing, known as tsukimi. Summer festivals were full of stands with merchandise coming from all over the country, and the most spectacular part of it were the extraordinary fireworks. Another sight was the Komuso monks. These were Buddhist priests with a distinctive outfit that included a woven basket completely covering the head. The monks wandered the country playing music and collecting alms. The basket was believed to strip the wearer of his ego and also had the added benefit of obscuring his identity from any prying eyes, which was useful as some monks also acted as spies for the shogunate. It was pretty common to see religious spokesmen at every corner attempting to convert people and raise funds for their temples. Although Neo-Confucianism was the official belief of the state, Buddhism and Shintoism were commonly accepted. Japan's isolation from foreign powers began a few decades after the beginning of the Edo era, and it was mainly caused by the fear of the Christian message and the spread of Western values. The country did not involve itself with the events occurring abroad, keeping their diplomatic relations with only a handful of countries, and just for the purpose of trading. Tokugawa's rigid Neo-Confucian values were intended to be the basis for a respectful and feared environment around the rulers, but the shogunate did not mean to force this philosophy to the lower classes. This was both to avoid an oppressive regime that would have led to revolts and to keep a significant distance between the values of the upper class and the ones of the commoners. A large amount of freedom, combined with a fast and unexpected wealth, led the merchants to have a hedonistic lifestyle, which they did in the so-called pleasure districts like the famous Yoshiwara district. Though samurai were discouraged from entering the area, they did so too, often in disguise as a commoner. This so-called floating world fostered a creation of hundreds of artworks set in this environment, inspiring the Ukiyo-e technique, celebrated as one of the most famous valuable art forms in Japan. Kabuki theater was a popular entertainment form among the lower classes, especially the merchants, more inclined to indulge in amusements than farmers and artisans, due also to the greater wealth they could rely on. Kabuki identified itself with the commoners, appealing to many for its fresh plots, to the extent that samurai also used to disguise themselves to enjoy the performances. Dried riverbeds hosted any kind of exhibitions, such as stunts performed by dogs and monkeys, juggling, sleights of hand. These divertissements were obviously associated with the pariah class, forbade to enter ordinary buildings and assist higher forms of theater. In order to keep the peace and safeguarding its power, the Bakufu dictated specific controls to whoever tried to get into Edo or in other major cities. Government guards were stationed at checkpoints and checked the passports of people going in and out and looked for any weapons coming into the city. This way, organizing eventual revolts became almost impossible. The checkpoints were also used to collect tolls from travelers. The Bakufu began to creak in 1853 when Commodore Perry and his fleet of modern warships appeared in Edo Bay with the goal of getting Japan to sign an agreement opening its ports to American trade. People became aware of the consequences of the isolation that had lasted for more than 200 years and the underdevelopments present compared to the rest of the world. A general discontent arose, and in just a few years, the Emperor's army was reorganized. The Imperial forces subjugated the Bakufu in a brief civil war in 1868, when the last shogun, Yoshinobu, gave up his power in favor of Emperor Meiji, who introduced the Enlightenment era in Japan. During the Tokugawa shogunate, Edo's destiny changed radically, transforming its identity and passing from being a small village without any relevance to an immense metropolis and symbol of the country. Edo became the best inheritance the shogunate could leave to the new rulers. Emperor Meiji chose to keep investing in the city, moving the empire domicile from Kyoto after more than a millennium. The emperor also changed the name of the city to Tokyo, meaning capital of the East. This episode was brought to you by Wix. Go to wix.com/go/simplehistory to create a professional site today. Wix has great features to bring your site to life, such as Wix Videos, Wix Pro Gallery, and Wix Bookings. Build your own website and support the Simple History channel by going to wix.com/go/simplehistory. Or simply click the link in the description below to get started.